Thank you, everybody. We'll call to have the city council workshop for Tuesday, March 14th, 2017, in order. First on the agenda is public input. Anybody who would like to address the council regarding any city business that's not on tonight's agenda? If you would like, please approach the podium, give me your name and address, please.
Sir, Herb Wilkie, 1017 7th Avenue. Stop by tonight to give you a little report on our turkey shoot this last Sunday. The weather was a little bit cool, a little bit of wind, but outside of that, really, really good day for shooting. We had 24 shooters identified. We had 22 events. We also had an Annie Oakley event. We had 8 people that bought insurance. We paid out 3. So we ended up giving out 24 prizes, I guess. We started at 9 o'clock and we were done wrapping up at 12:30. So we threw somewhere in the neighborhood of 600 birds. We had a great time.
Sounds like it.
And I got an idea to see any of the folks from here down there.
I was working. I wanted to make it.
Okay. Next time.
And do you have any more shoots?
Not any more turkeys. We got the membership party in the middle of May. And then possibly the Engineers Union. Probably in August, but we'll be coming back to the city council with requests.
Thank you very much.
All right, you're welcome.
All right, anybody else? Any other public comments? Seeing none, we'll move on to general items, to appointments. We have appointment to the World Ambulance Service.
And tonight I have with me Charlotte Steele and Jacob Hunt, and I'd like to introduce them as the two newest members of the ambulance service. Do you choose to report them?
Have them come up and join you.
This is my first time.
You're doing great. My second. So we have Jacob Hunt. And Charlotte Steele, correct?
Yes.
Well, the council will consider that, and that will be on the city council agenda for next Tuesday night for a vote to put you onto the ambulance service. I appreciate you wanting to join in your efforts in providing that service to the city of Laurel as important as it is. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, under general items, appointments, we have the park board, and we have a letter from Phyllis Bromgard, who would like to be considered to be on the park board, and I know there's vacancies, not more than one vacancy there, so I think that'll be on the here, so that was noted and moving on to executive review number 3.
Okay, the first item is a letter regarding intent for the countywide EMS consolidation, and I have Brad Shoemaker waiting for us to call so that you can ask him any questions. So let me put him on speakerphone and we can move that along.
Brad Shoemaker, Director of the County Safety Officer.
taking the time tonight to get together and put some discussion on into this. I really appreciate it.
Can everybody hear Brad?
Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Eaton?
Are we supposed to ask
Great. Brad's on the phone for any questions that you may have regarding the letter of intent. This really is just a letter of intent asking the county to investigate further this district-wide EMS service. You are not committing any resources, you are not committing any money, you are not signing on the dotted line. You are just saying, yes, go forward and see if this is even a viable possibility that Laurel could be included in. And so I think there's a lot of people that are very confused about what this letter is. It is not a letter committing the city to anything. It is just an expression of intent that, yes, we think it's a wise plan for the city to look, or excuse me, for the county to look into forming a district-wide ambulance service. And so to make sure that the deadline is met by April 1st, the letter would need to be discussed tonight, and then the council would need to agree to allow the mayor, not through a resolution, just an agreement of the council to sign the letter and send it to the county asking them to further investigate. But I wanted Brad on the line, and he only has a short amount of time due to his rural fire district meeting, to answer any questions that you may have before something is drafted up.
Councilmember Eaton still has her question.
I do, and my question is, which came first, a request from Laurel or a request from the county to Laurel with regard to Laurel participating in this? Did Laurel approach you, or did you approach Laurel with regard to this? Have funding to make this project go forward. Is that correct? You would have
That's
to.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. That's all I have. Thank you.
I believe Council President Pales, who is the chair of the Emergency Services Committee, which met last night discussing this issue, has a comment on this.
Emergency Services doesn't have an issue with looking into this. We did construct a letter. I don't know if Brad got a copy of that yet. I know it was just distributed to us. But there are some concerns with Laurel has in this. Number one is we would like to look at the possibility of three ambulances on the west side. Fully paid and volunteer, maybe a combination of those two. The issue being is we're concerned with being able to cover 100% of the calls. Some of the scenarios that we were talking about last night make one ambulance actually impossible to cover 100% of the calls. So we would like the county to pursue this, not just looking at one ambulance, but looking at multiple ambulances on the west side, whether they're staffed full-time for a combination of full-time and volunteers. And also that maybe we need to start, Laurel's thinking that maybe starting an ambulance district, which we may look into. I know somebody from Red Lodge is very good at that. And we're supposed to be getting her phone number to talk to her about ambulance districts and how
they were established. So we're talking about Laurel potentially starting an ambulance district independent of the county district?
Well, we don't know yet. I mean, we need to see some figures from you. Some of it is, I mean, you need to pursue this, Brad, but at some point we need to look at the dollars and cents of it, which we haven't seen yet. And until we can see some dollars and cents, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
If we're going to look at the dollars and cents on a big scale, we basically need to set the boundary lines of who we would include to try and figure out those dollar cents to make the service. So the question is just, you know, if we're going to build a service, do we want to look at it with Laurel in, or do we want to look at it with Laurel out?
The issue here is you're going to have to give us some information on both those scenarios. Maybe you need to sit down with, I know you're at the fire and EMS thing tonight, and you may need to sit down with those people and brainstorm with those people what this should look like. Because until those people are on board, I'm not sure this is going to fly. I'm not saying it can't, but I'm saying we need more information. In fact, two of the gentlemen who we've been through the mill levy situation in Laurel with them on emergency services, two very smart gentlemen, basically said last night, we don't have enough information to make a decision.
Well, I think that's exactly.
So I'm not opposed to getting more information.
Right.
So
you can't
pursue,
get more information.
Go ahead. But we need more information before we would ever commit to this.
Right, and I think everybody understands that,
yes.
But until you still have to send a letter back to the county that says, look for more information before April 1st. You
not opposed
have
to that
to send
at all.
That letter back. And
yeah.
So that's why we're talking about it tonight, to make sure that you meet that deadline so that you're not committing anything. And I think everybody understands there's a million questions out there and there'll have to be a lot of meetings to answer them. But is Laurel at least interested in being part of the district? If so, let's let Brad figure out the boundary and then figure out the dollars, figure out the resources, and then come back and actually have something to present.
I have nothing against the letter, specifically a letter.
What we're wondering is really, you know, do you guys even want me to spend my time figuring out answers to the questions for the area around Laurel?
I'm getting a lot of head nods, Brad,
yes.
in favor of that. I think there was a lot of confusion about resources being expended, and that is not the case at this time.
No, we're not asking for money
right.
or anything for
right.
Laurel at this time. Just
right.
just a head nod that you're interested in more.
Yes,
one
yeah.
of the things we are interested in is exactly your comment that you had tonight, which is that, you know, you would like to look at an option with more ambulances on the west side of the county. That's the kind of stuff that we want in the letter guys that are returning.
Right.
Is for you to say, yes, we want you to look into this. You know, we're not comfortable with one ambulance. Here are the reasons why we would like you to look into it with, you know, two paid full-time 24-hour or one paid full-time 24-hour and one additional 12-hour or 40-hour week ambulance or whatever options you want to see numbers on, this is the time to float out there what it is that you'd like to see.
And Brad, this is Council Member Nelson. Just to let you know that at the emergency services last night, we had a motion that was seconded and approved to make a recommendation to the council, just that you just stated. And we had, you know, requirements or quantities of and types of service that we wanted to include in that letter. So I'm sure that you'll see that when that letter comes. It'll be in that form that you just stated. We have one question from Councilmember Eaton that had asked a question for you.
Yes, thank you. I guess I'm a little bit confused. If this is just a letter saying that we want the county to pursue getting more information and more options, why is there a time limit, and why does that tie us in then to this whole scenario of time limits until there can be a bill that we pass.
Go ahead, Brett.
So the reason there's time associated with this is because if we leave it open and we make it where basically we can ask a million questions 100 times, like, so the county intends to take the letters that we get, build an informative RFQ, and put that out for potential bidders to send us basically their numbers. If we leave the time open and we don't give everybody a deadline to get your questions in, maybe we send that RFQ out and somebody comes in 2 weeks later with a long list of questions that they didn't get before because they didn't have any kind of deadline. Deadlines are just, it's what makes projects actually move forward as opposed to simmer on the stove with government, from my experience. So the deadlines are just so that the process continues, not to push anybody into making a decision or anything. It's just so that the process can move through the process as it has to. That's the only reason for the deadline.
Does that answer your question, Councilmember Eaton?
Well, I guess how are we supposed to make any decisions whether or not we want to go through if we don't have any answers?
Well, we'll get answers in the form of when the RFQ comes back, we'll know what the cost is going to be and associated with what our needs are and what the Shepherd, Warden, Huntley area needs are on the east side. And then that then can go and be plowed into the amount of taxable members of the county that are available to support the levy. That tells us what their cost would be for each of those taxpayers, and then that we then the conversation starts. You know, is this something that the taxpayers can afford? Is there something we can change? Is there something different we can do? Then look at options or creativity in trying to achieve the end goal with what we have available. I believe, correct, Brad?
That's spot on. We can't tell you how much it's going to cost a taxpayer until we know exactly, basically, which taxpayers would be in the service area and what services at what level it is that we're trying to propose. So we have to sit at the service level and the boundary so that we can find out how much a bid is, to get the state number, so we can set the boundary, so that we can do the division and get the low number. And then present that back to you guys and say, this is how it would cost, you know, per household, this is how much it would cost to implement it in this way or in another way, so that you guys can have a look at the numbers and make the decision there.
Councilman Reed?
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Shoemaker? No, everybody seems to understand what you've offered them in your dissertation of what you're trying to do with this and the accomplishments and the steps, I think. So hopefully we will get that letter to you in the requisite time and we can move forward one step at a time and review this as we go. And with any luck, we'll be able to succeed and get something provided for the county and city residences that are in need of a little extra.
I think that would be great.
Brad, I'll send you this information that the EMS committee put together last night, and then I'll obviously take a stab at this letter and make sure that it's circulated a bunch of times, and including the mayor, who's not here tonight, and. You know, I'll make sure that you have a draft of what goes before the council next week.
Okay. That's great.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Brad.
Thank you.
Yep, you guys have a good night.
You too.
If you guys have questions next week, please feel free to give me a call or shoot me an email.
Okay, I'll find out if they want to have you again on a call, and if so, I'll send you an email.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
All right, so that was countywide EMS consolidation, which we will be revisiting several times in the future. Yes, Councilman?
I would like to propose that I put together a letter for next Tuesday's meeting, but I also want you to include that, please.
Yeah.
I'll take the information from that and put it in a letter form since that's.
Yeah, sounds good. Thank you.
That almost mirrors what Brad was discussing with us, so yes, and that's going to be necessary for us in the city. So. Next on the executive review, we'll move on down the line here with resolution on SID 111.
Okay. I will actually kind of tag team this with the clerk treasurer tonight. Before our past clerk treasurer retires, Bethany and Shirley were going through the SIDs, and there was an error that was found in SID 111, and the error was an input error into Black Mountain about 7 or 8 years ago. So prior to obviously any of the staff that was there at the time, the amount of the SID was put in incorrectly, the time of the SID was put in incorrectly, the interest rate on the SID was put in incorrectly, so nothing with this SID was correct. There were some properties, a majority of them, that had paid off the SID already. There were some properties that had not, and then were continuing to make the payment on their taxes. So as soon as this was discovered, we obviously tried to take a very proactive step and contacted Dorsey and Whitney, our bond counsel, and asked them, what do we do? How do we fix this? What happened? It came down to, no one seems to know what happened. It appears that it was an input error into Black Mountain. Obviously, everyone's human, so to err is human, and that mistake was made. You cannot go back on the people that had already cleared the SID off. You can't go back and reevaluate them. The people that were currently still paying on the SID could be reevaluated. However, that was a very small portion of the SID, and the amount that would be received from those properties was also very incremental when you were looking at a total of $66,000. Being that the SID is in the TIF district, the most expedited way for the city to pay for this was to ask them if they would participate. So we asked Laura, obviously the TIF recommendary board, to the council, if they would be interested in helping the city pay off this SID. We explained to them that everyone in the district benefited. While this SID was created before the TIF district was, the property is still within the TIF district. It is an infrastructure improvement because it was a sidewalk improvement SID, and everyone in the district had not paid the full amount of their share. So everyone was in a financial gain, really, at that point. Laura was not super pleased with this. They don't want to be seen, or to have the TIF district be seen as a slush fund for heirs of the city. And so we explained to them that the interest, while the city could pay for it out of the general fund, not all in one lump sum out this year, this coming year, we'd have to pay it incrementally. The interest would keep compounding, and that we were just trying to fix a mistake that had been made prior to many of us being here. There was a lot of discussion, and then they held a special meeting just to talk about this. This was the only thing on their agenda. Understanding that we really truly were trying to fix the error, that we had not come to them before for just willy-nilly projects, and that the benefits of this were in the TIF district, and the benefits of helping Bethany and I figure out how to get out of this debt were also beneficial to the staff that provides them a lot of support. They did vote to have the TIF district pay off the full amount remaining of the SID 111 with TIF district dollars. Obviously, that amount is much greater than $5,000 and needs to come to you in a resolution. So I will now defer to Bethany in case I missed any other pertinent facts.
No, not only did we talk to bond counsel, we did talk to our city attorney.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. And Sam did agree that mm-hmm. this was legal. We could do it. It didn't break any rules or regulations mm-hmm. or anything. I mean, either the TIF district who's sitting on over $1 million pays for it, or the general fund that's already hurting pays for it. That's really the only choices that we have. Heidi and I are both not a fan of going back and trying to ask the taxpayers who are still paying on their SIDs to pay the full amount. Everybody was underassessed. It doesn't seem good to punish few and let others gain. It was the city's mistake. So once they pay off their SID, they pay off their SID in good faith. That's why we cannot go back and ask people who paid off their SID to pay the full amount. It's $66,000 in principal. The amount of money that we will get in 2017 and 2018 can pay off the interest. So that's why the TIF is only paying the principal. This SID was supposed to go until 2026. We are only getting assessments through 18, and we're only going to get $4,854.73. So as you can see, there is a huge gap between what we're going to get in assessments and what we have today. So we're coming to you because we need your approval for this, and whatever you decide, obviously we respect greatly, but the general fund is already hurting. So that's why I really don't want to take it from the general fund.
Councilmember Herter. Monsieur.
I have a question of the Kim. The people that have paid into this already, the property owners, are they going to be mad because the other people haven't paid into it and it's going to be paid by the TIF district?
No, they've all paid into it. All property owners have paid into it. Some
yes.
property owners have paid off their portion, and some are still currently paying. But everybody was assessed. They were all just assessed incorrectly and lower than the actual amount they were to pay.
So they'll pay the incorrect amount, and then once that's paid, they won't have to pay anything additional, is what you're saying.
And I made sure all the other SIDs are going to be coming in correctly. And I asked the auditors how it was dismissed, and we are going to go through some review of the company and figure out how it was missed, why it was missed, and make sure we never understand this terrible situation for everyone to be in. Especially when nobody's here to answer. We can't go, Heidi can't come in and say nothing we wanted to do. Because everybody that was involved, up to the mayor, is no longer here. So.
I'm sorry, but I don't recall what is Black Mountain. Function.
Of course, Black Mountain is the software we use. It's our accounting software.
Okay.
It's mainly for government entities. I think it's only for government entities. And this is strictly a data entry error.
Thank you.
I have a lot of questions, but go ahead, Councilmember.
Oh, I was just going to say that I can understand Laura being upset with being asked to pay for this, but it's almost a happy accident, maybe, that the SID district falls completely within the TIF district, and it is infrastructure, and so I can see where this would be a good solution to a problem.
It is, and I wanted to make it clear that they didn't just take it lightly, and I mean, They are very respectful of the money and are really have turned a leaf and working diligently to do good in the TIF district. And so they just wanted to make sure that it was understood that they would be a slush fund and that they weren't going to just pick up errors every time they happen. And so that's why they had the slush
fund. My turn?
Yes.
Anybody else? Bethany, do you know what the original TIF, or original SID 111 value was?
$162,000.
So, and that was the correct amount?
Yes.
And that was for a term of?
20 years.
So, you all know me. When I saw this on the Laurel agenda for a special meeting, I was wondering what was going on. So, I did my research and I found out. 2004. There was a special meeting called on Friday the 17th to get this item on the agenda for the following Tuesday the 21st of December of 2004. And apparently there was some other money that was available in a grant of some sort or another. I'm not sure but to the particulars of that. That just needed to be tied to in order to make this work for that, as a project for the SID. So it was discussed. I have the minutes of the meeting from December 17th where that was discussed. I've gone through that, and then I also have the minutes for the council meeting, city council meeting of December 21st. And the motion, who made the motion, but the motion was made by Alderman Mace to approve this. There was some discussion. And Alderman Pales mentioned, he said that page 3, section 8 says that special assessments for cost of the improvements shall be payable over a term not exceeding 15 years. A 12-year term was discussed at the special council meeting on December 17th. That's what was discussed on that in the minutes of that meeting was a 12-year term. So I hear it is 20, it should have been 20 years. Well, it wasn't entered on because Morrison Merrily was at this meeting, both of these meetings, and told us this was a 12-year term on this bond. So I just wanted everybody to know that it wasn't all just that. I don't know how much Morrison Merrily had to do with this or should have been responsible for. And it's all water under the bridge. It is in that TIF district. And it is worth it, possibly. And I hate to use that term because I had an engineer tell me that I needed to have a pad upriver because the city was going to have internet service for communications eventually anyway. I don't like being told that. So I wouldn't want to sit and tell my fellow members of the council that, you know, those sidewalks would have been paid by the TIF district anyway, because who's to know? But it appears that the consensus is that that's probably most likely going to happen. So I just want to put my two cents in. I did research that and look into it, and I think that there's more to it than you know, so long ago as Heidi says, 2004, that's just one time 13 years ago. But hopefully going forward, when we see things like that and there's questions about times, bonds, that we, no matter what the issue is, we pull the ring back and get it right. That's all I'm going to say. Go ahead.
And in regard to your 12-year term, that might explain why the payments were entered at 24. However, when it's signed, and there's a huge stack of paper that comes with those bonds when they have to be signed, it very clearly spells out all the details. So what might have happened is they may have entered it prematurely before we got all the documents, and then we didn't go back and change it. And that could be what has happened, and maybe that's a lesson for me. Don't enter anything into Black Mountain until you get your final signed documents, which I won't. But that might have been what happened, because it is the 24 payments and it should have been 40.
Thank you. Anybody else have any questions on this? Bruce?
Vice President Nelson, I don't have a question. I do have a comment. I'm glad that Bethany's gone back and looked at other things and verified it. I am gravely concerned, though, after your research, that what else is lingering out there? We escaped, with the help of Laura here, we kind of missing a bullet, you know, maybe not a terribly large bullet, but that $66,000 had to come out of the general fund. That would be a bullet to the general fund. There would be some things that would go with it, with wanting because of that. And so I hope that we're not having this experience again, or anything remotely close to a regular basis. And I completely understand and agree with Laura. I think we should thank them and convey to them we don't intend to treat the funds from the TIF district as a slush fund for us to use for emergencies. That's all I can say.
Thank you. Thank you. Moving on, resolution contract with Building 20CA.
the annual contract for the Millings YMCA to operate our municipal pool. The YMCA will operate the pool for the same amount that they did last year, which is $47,600, which is on the last page of your contract. As you know, the past few years have run much smoother under the direction of the YMCA, and everyone seems to be pretty happy with the service they provide. The pool is going to be painted prior to being open this season, so it certainly will look nicer for the visitors to the pool.
Any questions or comment on the pool contract with the YMCA? Seeing none, we'll move on to easier issues to tackle, such as the update on 2011 Yellowstone River flooding.
Well, I have some good news. We are back in the river. They are hoping to pour. The hole has been redug and dewatered. The pumps that have been submerged for all those months did fire back up, and they pumped the water out of the hole. The hole is dry. I'd say there's probably only about a foot of water left in it, but that's not a great concern until they're actually doing something in the hole. They are hoping to start pouring concrete on Friday, and then having it cure, and then keep moving forward. I asked for an updated schedule today at the construction meeting. They will be providing one next week, so we'll see where they think that this can be completed at. Most of the pipe has been laid. You can see how close they are to the intake, so that's really exciting, because even if we had an intake, you gotta tie it to something. So that's very exciting that the pipe's almost completed. Gas and power are going to be installed tomorrow. We did a small service agreement with a contractor to dig a trench from the existing gas and power lines that are on the west side of Red Bridge Road, and to get them across the road and then to our control building. Prior to the frost leaving the ground, that trench has been dug. We did use our city hydro excavator to make sure that we did not damage the gas line and that it would be exposed. MDU is on site today, and then they will be on site again tomorrow for the tie-in, and then Yellowstone Valley Electric will come in and put their power line on top. That we've currently been borrowing, or not we, but the contractor has an agreement with the McCoy property to borrow electricity for the control building now, and that's obviously a separate agreement. So it'll be nice to get our own power over there so that we can tie the generator up and get all the power going, which then our computer specialist, Clint Camper, can then start working on the communication between the control building and the water treatment plant, which has to do with the contract that you signed last week to bounce off the Green Oak Tower. So things are starting to move together and move along. So it was wonderful that the river finally broke, and that the pumps are working, and that we can get back in there and they can get pouring concrete.
Any questions or comments? I knew there'd be one.
Yeah.
Councilmember McGee.
So how are we looking on time?
Well, that's what I'm saying, is that next Tuesday they should provide an updated schedule.
Okay.
We had the date of substantial completion for April 1st, and a lot of that had to do with safety of the contractor, making sure that they were out of the river before runoff, and then being concerned about the April 15th ditch turn-on time, because usually, the ditches have the right to turn on April 15th. Last year they I believe turned on a little early because it was such a dry winter. This winter has been really wet, so I don't know when they'll turn on. I do believe they will run out of contract days and ask for an extension. However, as long as we can provide, as long as we can keep them safe and that the runoff isn't too high, I don't see a reason to not to grant them, because by golly, everyone wants to see this project completed. Tomorrow I will turn in an application similar to TSIP. Obviously, we did not get a TSIP grant through the 2017 legislature for the lowering of the intake in the river, which is a condition of our core permit. And I will turn in the legislature is, as part of their infrastructure bill, has created a sub group that would review additional infrastructure
projects that perhaps were not funded with the TSEP grants. So we'll actually be submitting two, one for our sedimentation basins and then one for the lowering of the intake. And so that'll go in tomorrow. So hopefully we can get some help with that project so that we can continue to stay in good graces with the Corps.
Councilmember McGee.
Thank you.
Seeing no other questions, we will move on. Number four, other items. I have none. We have our review of the draft council agenda for March 21st, 2017. Anybody have any questions on that? Everything look fine? There's not much there. Moving on, number six, the attendance for the March 21st council meeting next Tuesday. Would everybody present be able to make that meeting? No?
Maybe. I've got jury duty on Monday. I don't be called without being invited.
Hate it when that happens.
Something close.
I know.
We'll be well represented even if Council Member Herr is trying to take care of another matter. Announcements. I have none. Does anybody have any announcements? Council Member Hales.
No, sir.
Council Member Herr, anything?
No, sir.
Council Member Monsignor?
Yeah, I'd like to make a comment, if I could, and tell Heidi, I missed the emergency services meeting yesterday. So I'm kind of behind the eight ball, but on these 900 calls that were mentioned in this thing that the chief put out, I would like to know what the disposition is on these calls and how like threatening they were.
I'm sorry, sir, where are you looking at the 900 calls?
This? The 900 calls were brought up during the meeting. I've been told there were 900 plus calls in the last year.
Oh, it's not. Just got this, so I'm saying I don't know where that's at. Okay.
We were told that there were 951
emergency calls.
Yeah, last year.
For 2016, that's right.
Are you interested in how many of them were responded to?
No. What I'm interested in is how many of them were life-threatening calls, or how many of them were superficial, or you know, how many of them where they were called out and the people refused to take any medical treatment.
I'm not sure if we can track them.
I can tell you what they told us last night. We can ask the same questions. It doesn't make any difference if it's life-threatening or not. They're going to respond.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Like one example Brent Davis was, okay, they're called out to somebody who stubs their toe. They're not trained to diagnose whether that toe is broken or whether that toe is just stubbed and bleeding a little bit. They're trained to treat it and get them to a doctor. That's what they're trained to do. So they're not going to say whether or not that was an emergency if the toe is crushed or something. They're just going to take care of it. So the issue is they go out on a call and yeah, it's a stubbed toe. And our concern is the second call is a heart attack. And we don't have coverage to cover that heart attack. That's why we're asking for 100% call response. That's why we suggested to Brad that we may need three ambulances on the west side of the county so that we can make that 100% coverage. Instead of, one example was somebody's mother called the ambulance. This happened with AMR, not in Billings. And it took 2 hours for AMR to show up. And we don't want that to happen here. And so that's why they don't track how many calls they are emergent or not. But they did tell us there was 137 calls that they didn't make. They had to refer to somebody else from Future Lake. Which is like a 14%. Could not have come up with this. He is an ex-pilot.
Yeah.
And if you're going to call on this airplane and the crew chief's going to say, yeah, we think it's fixed up all right, but there's a 14% chance it's not going to fly, are you getting that airplane to fly?
That seems awful low.
Well, that's the figures they have, but that's what they gave us. So that's all I can say.
I consider this kind of a utopia type thing. I mean, they're saying they need 3 ambulances, okay? What happens if they get 4 calls? They still can't make 100% coverage.
Well, to answer your question, Councilmember Monsieur, when there's a 911 call and somebody calls back and says, oh, my kid's screwing around, the police department goes and investigates. When there's a fire call and somebody calls back and says the kid was playing with a spark gun, the fire department rolls and they investigate. Same with the ambulance when there's a call. No matter what that calls for, the ambulance has to go and has to investigate. The point that you were trying to get to, and I understand, and there's a lot of that that's been going on, and it's been increasing our calls for things that what most people would assume someone would take themselves to minor emergency for, that are not necessitating a ambulance to arrive at the scene to deal with that particular issue. But nonetheless, that is their function. We have determined that 3 ambulances in the southern end of, or the southwestern end of Yellowstone County would be necessary in order to take care of the county's needs, plus the city's needs. And we know that we need 2 ambulances to take care of the city's needs, which, whether by volunteer or not, is necessary. Even with what we have, we need, if we're offering a service, we need to provide that service. There, and then if you're taxed beyond that point, then that's where you have mutual aid. And then mutual aid comes in and provides that service, which is expected, and there's no issue with that. Once you've expended your ability to serve with your equipment and personnel, then mutual aid comes in and takes those calls. So that's why we are looking at that number of 3 to make it work and look properly to take care of the city and the state. So,
and they also did mention that the ambulance quite often, don't know how often, but they may go transport somebody to the hospital in Billings, and they get called out before they get back, so they return with some lights and sirens to another call. And so the issue of 4 calls, hopefully they don't come all within 3 minutes of each other. It could happen, obviously, but what we're hoping is you have the 3 ambulances, the first one's in there ready to return, and they respond to the 4th call.
Yeah, if there was an airline,
or you go to a mutual aid agreement.
If an airplane crashed in Molt, we would respond with all of our resources because of that mutual aid agreement.
My suggestion would not necessarily tell the county that you want 3 ambulances. I believe that's part of their investigation, is to determine how many ambulances mm-hmm. are needed. So I think it will probably be worded in your letter of some way other than like a demand of a minimum of 3 ambulances.
Well, or minimum required ambulances to respond to 1,000 plus emergency calls.
I think that seems more reasonable than
that sounds fine by
dictating to them, because that's exactly what this letter intent is for them to investigate how many calls were here, how many calls were missed, how many calls they can predict, because I mean they're pretty good at that. That's why MR is still in business. So.
And I know it's grown, because when I was first on council and first in emergency services, their call volume was between 350 and 400. So it's literally more than double.
And I believe the main crux of that was that we wanted to impress on the county that 1 ambulance was not going to do it, and we wanted to make sure that whatever they looked at, that it included a mutual aid compact with the city of Laurel, because we know 1 ambulance county provided for the city and the rest of the county out here in this end of the county will not work. So. And that had been brought up that mutual aid was maybe a sticking point with them because of costs associated with the levy to taxpayers. So that's why we wanted to make sure that they know that we're thinking of mutually. Councilmember Martinez?
I'm sorry?
Was that it?
Well, yeah, but my comment about, you know, needing three ambulances, I understand what you're saying. But what I'm saying is that, what you're saying is that's a guess, projected guess you can make at this point, what you're going to need for coverage, okay? It could exceed that.
I can guarantee you.
Then you have to go to mutual.
I'll guarantee you one thing, we'll have plenty of discussions about this over the next year.
Oh, sure.
So.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Councilmember Deppenson?
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember McGee, you have anything?
I don't have anything, thank you.
Councilmember Eaton?
Yes, thank you. I understand that there may have been some confusion yesterday because there was no Public Works meeting. I did announce it at the last meeting that the council had, but certain council people were not here, and certain citizen members of the Public Works meeting obviously were not here, and for whatever reasons, staff didn't send out a letter, didn't even send out a notice that there might be a Public Works meeting. And so I wanted to apologize for those people who were inconvenienced by lack of communication. I will warn members that there may not be an April meeting. That's all going to be dependent on events, of course, that the city may or may not be taking on, and the health of the Public Works Director. So just stand forewarned that there may not also be another April meeting, but I will try to send out a personal notice if it doesn't look like the staff will be doing that. So. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you, Councilmember Eaton. We have number eight. We have recognition of employees. So we have two. Jason Wells, 19 years of service. And that's coming up on the 18th. And Christopher Herb at the library, 8 years of service on the 11th of March. So again, if you see those people, acknowledge that a lot of hard work working for the city, and a lot of times it goes unrecognized, and even little things would always be helpful, I'm sure. In lieu of that, I just have one item, and that's to let Herb Wilkie know that I am filling in for the mayor, so we got off lucky. You don't have to buy coffee for everybody at the Owl Saturday for your cell phone ringing. So just to let you know.
For what?
For your cell phone ringing earlier.
Oh,
you, you got off spot free on the coffee bill. So. But, we'll be watching this.
My sincere apologies.
All right, this meeting is adjourned.
Okay, bye.